Thank you very much. It's a great privilege to be here and especially to speak in your chapel, although I have to say I think a lecture is a rather poor substitute for prayer and music. I'm working right now on a book on prophecy and contemporary society and ministry, and I'm looking for how prophetic inspiration may be functioning in the contemporary church. I'm convinced that one place the prophecy functions is through the work of religiously inspired artists. And so that is the focus of this lecture, the artistic function of prophets and the prophetic function of artists. As I understand that function, it's to give us symbols that guide us in living more wisely, more faithfully. And in this lecture, I'm going to focus on one biblical prophet, Jeremiah, who I think does that. In his capacity as an artist, Jeremiah is certainly one of the greatest Hebrew poets of all time. His particular prophetic vocation was to preside over the unthinkable, namely the collapse of the royal house of Jerusalem, the royal house of David, the fall of Jerusalem in 586 BC. So I'm going to focus on this biblical artist and prophet, and at the same time, I'm going to pay some attention to artists in our own day who have recognized that it is their vocation, their specifically Christian vocation, to reflect on the unthinkable events of our own day. One of these contemporary artists whose work has some prophetic dimension is the painter, the New York painter Makoto Fujimura, whose New York studio is less than a mile from Ground Zero, where the Twin Towers collapsed 10 years ago. And this is what he says about what I am calling the prophetic function of an artist. The Creator God has given us creativity in the arts so that we may name experiences, just as God commissioned Adam to name the animals in the garden. In the fallen realities of our days, God continues to affirm our creative responses to the darkened horizon. And by naming the indescribable, we may yet rediscover our hope to endure yet another dark day. Naming the indescribable. I think Jeremiah would know what Mako means and would affirm it. Jeremiah had the least enviable of all prophetic vocations, prophesying for more than 40 years as Judah descended inexorably into the hell of destruction and exile. And as you know, 40 years is the Bible's round number for a hell of a long time. Eventually, God told Jeremiah to stop praying for the people of Israel. They were not going to change short of destruction. They were literally past praying for. Yet in a situation that must have seemed utterly hopeless, without a future, Jeremiah wrote this beautiful Hebrew poetry, poetry that has endured for 2,600 years already, poetry that still speaks to us of God's unbreakable bond with us, of God's heartbreak over us. Jeremiah chapter 31. Isn't Ephraim, Israel, a precious child to me, a cuddly boy? And so my body yearns for him. This is God speaking. My body yearns for him. I will surely have compassion on him, an utterance of the Lord. That is one pole of Jeremiah's prophecy, the long-term vision, the pole of hope. But here is the short-term vision, the opposite pole. Thus says the Lord, stand by the roadway and look and ask about the ancient paths. "Which is the good way? Go that way and find rest for yourselves." But they said, "We will not go." And I raised up for you watchmen. "Give heed to the blast of the trumpet." And they said, "We will not give heed." "Hear, O earth, I am about to bring evil upon this people, the fruit of their designs. For they have not heeded my words and my teaching, they have rejected it." I believe that Jeremiah is a prophet whose time has come again, who can speak to us precisely because he has the lifelong experience of prophesying straight into hell, and yet saying something that in the end yields hope. Hope after much chastening. I intend to do two things in the next 30 minutes. First, working with the words of Jeremiah, I shall consider the gifts and inspiration of this prophet, and also the disciplines he keeps, disciplines which bear fruit in certain modes of prophetic poetry. I name those things, and if I could have the next slide, please. I name those things, gifts, disciplines, modes of Jeremiah's art at the outset, and each one of those is threefold. First, the prophetic gift that the great writer on the prophets, Abraham Joshua Heschel, called insight. And coupled with prophetic insight, the gift for concrete expression. Second, the prophetic disciplines of bearing pain and at the same time bearing with God through pain. And third, the particular prophetic arts that Jeremiah brings to perfection in his poetry. First, covenantal condemnation, naming Israel's sin before God, and second, lament, naming pain and its sources with some precision, naming it before God. More than any other prophet before him, Jeremiah names his own pain, and he does something no one else before him had done, namely articulating God's own cry of pain. As I explore these elements of Jeremiah's prophecy, I'm going to show you a few images from modern artists who, in my judgment, exercise some of those prophetic gifts and disciplines, and have thus produced art that might be said to have a prophetic dimension. So, beginning with the prophetic gifts of insight and concrete expression. Abraham Joshua Heschel contrasted insight with ordinary seeing, which, as he says, is often not seeing at all. The prophet's gift, or to use a Christian metaphor, the prophet's cross to bear, is first to see with clarity what others do not see, maybe what others choose not to see. The prophet sees it and then communicates it, framing it in words and sometimes in physically embodied sign acts. Prophecy is about seeing our present situation in divine perspective, using language so vivid that the depiction becomes not just memorable, but inescapable. Just because we cannot get away from those depictions, they enable us to see ourselves clearly, and so, if we heed them, to turn and be healed. Thus, those prophets that arise from the hell of the prophetic imagination might become, for those who heed them, a source of hope. It would be hard to find a more striking instance of that clear, painful insight expressed in concrete images than Jeremiah's vision in chapter 4 of de-creation. He's anticipating or witnessing the ravages of war on Judah. And this is what he says. I have seen the earth, and here it is, wildness and waste. That's, he's quoting from what we would call Genesis 1, wildness and waste, without form and void. I've seen the earth, and here it is, wildness and waste. I've seen the heavens, and their light is gone. I've seen the mountains, and here they are, wavering, and all the hills palpitate. I have seen, and here there is no human being, and all the birds of the skies have fled. I have seen, and here the garden land is now the wasteland, and all its cities are pulled down because of the Lord, because of his heated wrath. As I say, what Jeremiah is experiencing is war overwhelming the land of Judah, but he depicts it as the end of life on earth, exploding that double meaning of the Hebrew word echetz, which can mean either this land or what we would call the whole planet earth. Jeremiah can afford to be spare in his poetry because what he is saying is so clearly a reversal of the great poem of creation that we know as Genesis 1. The world is reverting to tohu vavohu, waste schmaste. Jeremiah sees and shows the mountain frame of the earth coming apart, the rich greenery on its face stripped down to barrenness. Humans and birds, those orders of creatures that once received God's blessing, humans and birds disappear. Cities are torn down because of the Lord, because of his heated wrath. I find this image from Jeremiah especially haunting in our, what you might call, age of decreation. It's these words from chapter 4 that came to me when I stood on a mountaintop removal site in Kentucky, where we have done something both unthinkable and irremediable, stripping away the very mountain frame of the earth, exploding mountains off the face of the earth. Jeremiah's words reveal to us, and I'm using reveal in the strong sense there, they reveal to us how what we are doing in Kentucky and Appalachia, this is a crime against God, one that strikes at the very God-given structure of reality. Next slide, please. Emil Nolde's 1912 woodcut, The Prophet, captures something of what Heschel calls the pain of insight. And this brings us now to the prophetic discipline of bearing pain. Bearing pain and bearing with God through pain. The prophet is suspended in the terrible middle space between God and the doomed people of Judah, the people Israel. The prophet is unable to turn away either from God or from the people. And Jeremiah is the prophet who most fully expresses the pain of occupying that middle space between the two. I'm reading to you from chapter 8. For the brokenness of my dear people, I am broken. I go in mourning. Desolation has taken hold of me. Healing balm. Is there none in Gilead? No doctor there? So why is the open sore of my dear people not healed? If only my head were water and my eyes a font of tears, so I could weep day and night for the slain of my dear people. The slain of my dear people. I think that phrase captures precisely the tragedy in which this prophet is enmeshed. He sees his own people, he sees what they do not see, and he knows that they are doomed. Next slide, please. I see the 20th century Fritz Eichenberg occupying that same space between God and a doomed people, with his image that he calls the Lamentations of Jeremiah. It was made in 1956. It reflects, you can see in the background there, the devastation of war. Fritz Eichenberg was a German. He grew up in World War I. He was an assimilated Jew and therefore had to flee the Nazis in 1938. He came to the US and eventually became a Quaker. And in this image, as I say, 1956, I leave it to you to judge. Is it an image of Germany in the middle of the 20th century? Those look like churches destroyed in the background, possibly synagogues. Or is it, he calls it the Lamentations of Jeremiah, is it Jerusalem in the 6th century BC? Certainly it has elements of both in that image. Eichenberg, as I said, eventually became a Quaker in the United States, and some of his most powerful, possibly some of his most prophetic work has Christological themes. Next slide. Including this crucifixion in the Totentanz tradition. If you could read, and perhaps you cannot, if you could read what looks like a blackboard there on the upper right, you would see it's the names of the concentration camps, the death camps in which Jews were killed. He's doing it, this Nazi SS officer in the front. He's a skeleton dressed in an SS uniform. And Eichenberg is working here in the tradition of European art, of German art, known as Totentanz, the dance of death. Next slide, please. Here I'm showing you a traditional image from Hans Holbein in the 16th century. Holbein really brought this tradition of the dance of death to its culmination. It's an artistic tradition that is a kind of commentary on current social situations. It shows what is killing people, traditionally famine, plague, war, and this is exactly what Eichenberg is picking up on. Next slide, please. Another of his explicitly Christological images is his Pietà. And again, I wish you could see the images more clearly, but they are very evidently Jewish faces on both Jesus and his mother, in some contrast to much European art in which they look Northern Italian, perhaps. Returning to Jeremiah, this prophet argues with God more than anyone since Moses. He protests to God, knowing exactly how little good it will do him. From chapter 12 of Jeremiah, "You are in the right, O Lord, whenever I contend with you. Yet I would speak about matters of justice with you. Why does the way of the wicked prosper, and all those who commit treachery are at ease? How long will the land grieve or be parched," it's the same word in Hebrew, "and the grain of every field be dried up?" Jeremiah lived through a terrible drought, just as you were living through. "How long will the land be parched, grieve, and the grain in every field be dried up? On account of the evil of those who dwell in it. Beasts and birds are finished off, because they," the evil, "say, God does not see our future." Jeremiah has a decent point, but God is not sympathetic. "If you race with runners and they wear you out," God says to Jeremiah, "then how are you going to compete with horses? How are you going to do when things really get tough?" God is pretty edgy. But still, Jeremiah keeps up his strident lament. No one else in the Bible dares speak to God like this. "Yes, you know. O Lord, remember me and take account of me. Know that it is on your account that I endure ridicule. I have not sat in the company of the rowdy living it up. Because of your hand, I have sat alone, for you have filled me with indignation. Why is my pain perpetual and my wound incurable, defying healing? Certainly you, this is speaking to God, certainly you have been to me like a deceptive stream, waters that cannot be relied upon. Jeremiah's complaints, they're traditionally called confessions, but they're complaints. Jeremiah's complaints cluster in the early part of his book, the first 20 or 50 chapters, as Jeremiah learns to bear the weight of God's hand with all the misery and the isolation it brings him. These poems of lament are the evidence that Jeremiah is an artist who creates even through suffering, despite and even out of his suffering. He speaks to and for God through a conflict with God that may never be resolved. Jeremiah prophesies through conflict with God and also through conflict within himself. He cries out, wishing he had never been born, castigating the people he loves and with whom he identifies as family, my dear daughter people. Jeremiah utters a deeply conflicted message. In one, the place perhaps that this is clearest is in his series of oracles against Babylon, the great enemy. And he starts with his famous letter to the exiles in chapter 29, in which he writes to the Judeans in exile in Babylon, telling them, seek the shalom, the peace, the well-being of the city to which you have been exiled, for in it shalom is yours shalom. It's a message of reconciliation, but it's very hard to hold that message together with the lengthy diatribes against Babylon that bring Jeremiah's book to an end. These are vengeful, no holds barred anticipations of Babylon's downfall at God's hands. The sound of a cry from Babylon and a massive rupture from the land of the Chaldeans, for the Lord is devastating Babylon. Her mighty warriors are captured, their bows are shattered, for the Lord is a God of recompense. Inevitably, he pays back. Jeremiah contradicts himself freely. He foregoes the luxuries of consistency, of resolution, of anything that might conventionally be seen as the basis for firm hope in God. That is the hell Jeremiah endures in his own prophetic imagination. And precisely in that lack of resolution, he may be a model for ministry in our own time. If we seek to build and to plant as Jeremiah was charged to do, then we must do that in a world where very little is holding firm. Jeremiah models the kind of frank speech that might be called prophetic even in our own day. Confessing what it is to be a prophet as Judah descends into hell, Jeremiah disabuses us of the notion that if our own situation for ministry is agonizing, then we have missed our vocation. He strips us of the excuse that a God who has disappointed our most fervent hopes, such a God cannot be worthy of worship. Jeremiah says, you're kidding yourself if that's what you think. A third focus, Jeremiah's two art forms, covenantal condemnation and lament. Jeremiah's experience of sticking with God through bitter disappointment constitutes part of his authority as a prophet. It qualifies him to speak words of divine condemnation to a people who has turned away from God because God has disappointed their hopes. The two primary forms of Jeremiah's art, condemnation and lament, they're siblings, they're even twins. They're usually together and they look a lot alike. Because both condemnation and lament are expressions of God's covenantal commitment to Israel, a commitment that the prophet shares. So listen first to the condemnation. Proclaim against Jerusalem. Enemies are coming from a land far away. They will cry out against the cities of Judah. Like keepers of fields, they are all around her, for it is against me, this is God speaking, it is against me that she rebelled, an utterance of the Lord. Your ways and your deeds, they have done this to you. This is your evil, and it is bitter. It strikes even to your heart. So that's the condemnation, and now comes the lament, the cry from the stricken heart, and the language is not delicate, but you know that already. You've been listening to Jeremiah for 30 minutes. My guts, I writhe, the walls of my heart. My heart is in tumult within me. I cannot be still, for I hear the blast of the trumpet, the bugling of war. But whose heart is it that is stricken like this? Whose guts are writhing? Is it Jeremiah? Or could this lament come from Jerusalem, the doomed city itself? And that latter possibility, that it's Jerusalem, seems more likely as we read the next verse. Disaster, I'm in chapter 4, verse 20. Disaster after disaster announced, for the whole land is wrecked. Suddenly, my tents are wrecked, my fabric in an instant. How long, it's an image of battle tents, how long shall I see the battle standard, hear the blast of the trumpet? That lament could come from Jerusalem's own heart, as I've said, but the poet keeps violating the boundaries of our comprehension. We think we know who's speaking here, and then it becomes unclear as this verse that sounds like Jerusalem speaking blends seamlessly into what is certainly God's own cry of anguish. For my people are foolish. They don't even know me. They are witless children. They are not insightful. They are skilled in doing evil, but they don't know how to do good. Jeremiah is an artist, a poet, who represents with consummate skill both human folly and human grief, and likewise divine judgment and divine grief. I find something of that same blend of affect, grief and judgment, accusation, I find some of that same blend of affect in the woodcuts of Margaret Adams Parker. Next slide, please. Margaret Adams Parker is an avowedly Christian artist. She's a very close friend of mine, and I recently saw that someone described her as an activist artist. And she consciously responds to current events that otherwise seem to be unthinkable. This first image, it's called Fruits of the Tree. She did it in 2004. It was her artistic response to the invasion of Baghdad. And you'll see from the next slide that she's quoting a 15th century artist. It's modeled on Masaccio's Expulsion from Paradise. Early 15th century. So you can see burning Baghdad in the background as the man and the woman, Adam and Eve, are fleeing. Next slide, please. This is To See What I Have Seen, 2006. It is based on Margaret Adams Parker's the descriptions of her son, who's a medical doctor. the description of his medical school rotation in the psychiatry ward in a VA hospital, working with vets from our current ward. And you can see there, if you could see it closely, you would see media images from the war behind this man who is crying out to see what I have seen. Next slide, please. She also does more traditionally Christian images. This is, but at the same time, they're a commentary on current events. This is her Pietà. With Mary imaged as a traditional Palestinian woman of any century, including our own, holding her son's body, very evidently a lifeless body. It's a rather timeless image, I think. And the next slide, please. And this is Margaret Adams Parker's, one of her own images. She also works in this tradition called Totentanz, Dance of Death, which, as I said, points to things in to contemporary events that are leading to death. This is her own reflection on mountaintop removal and the poisoning of the waters of Appalachia, the deforestation of that richest temperate forest in North America. I'm going to close with one more passage from Jeremiah that blends condemnation and grief, even as it blends voices both divine and human. Look, I am about to send against you poisonous snakes that have no charmer, and they will bite you, and there will be no recovery, an utterance of the Lord. Grief is upon me. My heart is sick. Listen, the cry aloud of my daughter, people from the far reaches of the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is there no king in her? Why have they enraged me with their carved images, with foreign idols? Harvest has passed, summer is over, and we have not been saved. For the brokenness of my dear people, I am broken. I go in mourning. Desolation has taken hold of me. And here we are back now at the lament with which I began this lecture. And I told you then that it was Jeremiah speaking, for the brokenness of my dear people, I am broken. But now we have somewhat less reason to be certain that it is Jeremiah. Could it possibly be God throughout? God, who certainly is speaking here, why have they enraged me with their carved images? God, who a few chapters later will lament, my heritage has become to me, speaking of Israel, my heritage has become to me like a lion in the forest. Israel, Judah is like a lion, and the Lord God of Israel is its prey. In chapter 12, with that image of God as the lion's prey, Jeremiah is giving us an image of God as victim, and possibly here also, God crying out in anguish. And thus, Jeremiah is pointing the way to Jesus. Jesus, the prophet, and more than a prophet, whose words echo Jeremiah's words no less than they do the prophet Isaiah's. Jeremiah is pointing to Jesus, the God-man, who is broken on the cross, broken by and for his beloved people, exactly as Jeremiah had said. In this short lecture, then, I have pointed to the words of a prophet-poet, Jeremiah, and the works of several artists, past and present, who may help us reflect on the otherwise unthinkable, in the various ways we encounter the unthinkable and also commit unthinkable deeds. That would seem to be a central service, helping us see and reflect upon the unthinkable, a central service of artists and prophetic thinkers in every generation. And surely no generation needs their service more than does our own. Thank you.